Anything can happen in the theater, the musical world, and more. Yeston press conference, where James Morgan gave an introduction, Maury Yeston, and then Gerard Alessandrini talked about the musical numbers first, Anything Can Happen in the Theater, You're There Too, and Home. And then I got to interview the company, the choreographer, the director, and the composer and lyricist.
This is the press sneak peek of our latest main stage show, actually the first main stage show of our 50th anniversary season. We're delighted to share it with you. I saw an early version of this show like 2 years ago at the Triad, and watching it, I thought this would be perfect for us to do. And they fought and fought. They didn't want to bring it here. No, that's not true. Happily, that's not true. And it's just come together beautifully. There was a, years ago, I remember the first, like a press something for the original La Cage. Arthur Lawrence was quoted as saying, "We're just having a love fest." Well, I would say the same thing. It's been a love fest. And when you hear this incredible cast, well, you've already heard it. You will know what we mean, what I'm talking about. Anyway, our incredible cast, I hope I get everyone's name very easily, ladies and gentlemen. Alex Gatlin. Giovanni Sean. Mamie Paris. And Justin Keith. Himself, Mr. Maury Yeston will say a few words.
Welcome to you, members of the press. It's always wonderful to be here in New York, especially now they're celebrating.
Would it be better if you set one stay in for a while?
Sorry. This is making me make it really up for
He's vamping.
50 years. Where were we all 50 years ago? Well, I can only speak for myself. I wasn't born yet. 50 years. Good God. Was that the 60s? I don't even remember. I remember a swing and a high chair. In any case, can you imagine how much New York, this hallowed institution, is part of the history of the American theater now, and the history of particularly the American musical theater. So it's kind of sacred ground, because how many things started here? How many actors started here? How many writers got their first shot at being on stage? How many people fell in love with theater here? And so it's not any old theater. You know, each theater has its histories and its traditions. You know, my first show was in a theater called the 46th Street Theater. It's now called the Richard Rogers Theater. And when I was 10 years old, my mom took me to that theater to see a show called How to Succeed in Business. And there is this man named Robert Morse, or Bobby Morse. And in the middle of that, I was just a kid. In the middle of that, he came right here, right to the middle of the stage, and he looked out at nothing. And he pointed. I guess he was in the men's room, right? And he started singing, "You've got the cool, clear look of a seeker."
Into the mirror.
Into the, well, what mirror?
But it was a Bengali mirror.
And I was 10 years old. And I'm looking at this. "You've got the cool, clear look of a seeker of wisdom and truth. I believe in you." And I'm looking at that and I'm saying, "Wait a minute. Oh, it's a mirror." So at the age of 10, I supplied in my mind his mirror. And it's then that I learned something about theater that I have fallen in love with and that exists in everything I write and do on stage since that time. Which is actually, I said this in an interview in the New York Times, and they printed it as the quote of the week, which is that the theater is a lie in which we harpoon the imagination of the audience in creating with us the illusion that's on stage. We need you to do it. I, a 10-year-old, supply the mirror. And so to be here in New York and do excerpts from pieces of musical theater with nothing but actors and very nice clothes on it, and a piano. And this show will put you on a beach. We'll put you on the Titanic. We'll put you in the middle of the Bible. We'll go God knows where we'll put you. Anywhere and everywhere, and we have no scenery. It's a bare stage. And this is why that first production of mine, that some of you may have seen, at the 46th Street Theater, and oh, by the way, how many years later, at the 46th Street Theater, in exactly the same spot, my friend Raul Julia looked out on a bare stage with nothing but white boxes and sang, I want to be here, I want to be there, I want to be there. So that was sort of a great moment in my life. And so is this, because Gerard, who I have known ever since he was a student at the BMI workshop, I had just taken over teaching it from Lehman Engel, who had passed away. And Gerard came in and, you know, well, we knew right away, you know, when, Schumann, the composer, had a magazine called the Musical Observer, Musikalische Beobachter. And there was this 18-year-old kid who came and showed up his music. His name was Johannes Brahms. And Schumann wrote an article with a big headline, Hats Off, Gentlemen, a Genius. And so when Gerard came in and started doing his thing, we all knew that he was really somebody very special. Not only very special in terms of writing genuine musical theater, but making fun in a way that was so bright and so brilliant. And Gerard plowed his wonderful path and created Forbidden Broadway, the longest running off-Broadway review in the history of the world. And Spamalot, and who knows what he's going to do tomorrow. He's been dear friends ever since, and he's known me ever since he sat there when I was, you know, writing new songs and things like that. And he said, let's go up to the Triad, and he said, I would like to do a show based on your work. And I said, fine. And so we got together, and we put some songs together, and Greg played the piano. And it was a hell of a lot of fun. And Jim came and said, you know, this just feels so right for the York. Would you think about doing it in the York? And I said, oh, absolutely, yeah. What a wonderful idea. I said that he would be kicking off his 50th anniversary. And I thought, well, that just makes it incredibly more special and more meaningful to me, and I'm sure to all of us. And I hope to the supporters and the members of the York community that have been so wonderful in supporting it over the years. So, I don't want to tell you anything more because if a piece of theater is supposed to work, it's supposed to work on its own terms, right? Robert Morse will not be here. along with some other people. So, thanks for coming. And we'll answer questions later. How about a couple of words from Gerard?
Hello. 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 Good afternoon, everybody. I'm so happy to be here at the York Board with Maury Yeston, who is one of my idols, and I love his music and lyrics profoundly, and I think many of us do too. And it's so wonderful to have a show that's now and that's new that has such great music and lyrics, because we don't hear that very much in theater anymore, unfortunately. So hopefully this will steer people in the right direction. We have a tremendous cast. And I love them all. They're all the geniuses, and they're all like beautiful voices, good actors. They look great, great triple threat. And I'm very happy also to be here at the York, where I think I've only done one reading here. I've never actually worked here, although we've been talking about it for years. But it's such a great space. It's intimate, yet it's a theater. They can put up a beautiful proscenium for you, as Jim has done. I also have been looking forward to working here or with Jim, because I love his set designs, many of the shows I've seen. Anyway, shall I get right to it and introduce the numbers that we're going to do? Is that all right? Does that work?
Yes.
Okay, we're going to start with the opening number of the show, and then we're going to do You're There Too, and then we're going to end with one of our finales. We have a couple of encores, but one of our finales, Home, which is from Maury's Phantom. His version of Phantom of the Opera that has been done all over the world and is beloved by many. And these are just three samplings of the many different types of music and songs we have in this show. And I'm thrilled by all the variants in style and subject matter, and I think you will be too. So here we go. We're going to start with the opening number, Anything Can Happen in the Theater.
The actor's corpse. They wanted me to play the corpse, lying motionless on stage. Obviously no lines because...
You're dead.
Never gets any easier, does it? What, you two? The actor's corpse?
No. No. Worse. An Italian film director with a midlife crisis? Who writes this stuff?
You're right. That is worse.
Adjacent to my shoe. And I'm not surprised to find I my special.
I get lost in the dark and don't know what to do.
Jacob Zedek, who's back there at the lighting table. And the sound is by Julian.
So my name is Alex Getlin. I play Woman 2 in the show. There are two women, and I am the second one. I've been a part of this show since the first iteration of it at the Triad Theater that happened 2 years ago, and I'm so happy that this has gotten a second life at the York. It's taken shape into something so theatrical and so beautiful. something I really love about the songs that you're going to hear in this show and in Maury's work generally is that every single piece is such a distinctive world, and he does such a gorgeous job, both lyrically and melodically, of painting such a specific picture that each moment and each song lands you in a totally different place than you were from the previous one so completely. And so I think when you come see it, you'll have this very cool and strange and odd experience of being taken from world to world to world seamlessly. And I think that's something that Maury does brilliantly and that I'm so honored to be a part of.
This music always kind of chokes me up, and as a singer, you do not want to be choked up, so how do you sing through that?
You know, you have a, I personally, you have a trial period where you, the first time I sang Danglin' in my room, I wept uncontrollably. They are such gorgeous, gorgeous songs, but after you begin inhabiting them a little bit and thinking about them and just, they come to life in such a way that it becomes the audience's job to like have the response to it rather than my own, and it just, you just become the storyteller of the situation and the narrative and whatever feelings arise from that for everyone else. And that's the beauty of Maury's work and great songs in general, is that they take the audience member on a journey and the actor, but they are two distinct ones.
I just thought something else that's troublesome for a singer, that, I mean, comic timing. I mean, when you're doing a straight comedy, it's easy, but you're singing comic timing. How do you do that?
How do you sing comic timing? I don't really, I think it just happens. I think when you have some, hi, Mamie, when you, how do you sing comic timing? I think when someone writes as brilliantly, when someone writes as smartly as Maury does, it truly just becomes your job to sing the material, and it is naturally funny because he has, you don't have to add too much to it. It's really all perfectly written in there. So I don't exactly know how you sing comic timing, but it does happen. So come see it happen.
Justin Keys.
And so tell them about the show and what your songs are and all that.
Well, I'm not going to tell you what my songs are because I want you to buy a ticket, but the show is called Anything Can Happen in the Theater at the York, and it's the musical world of Maury Estin. So there are songs from Nine, from the December songs, from Grand Hotel, and some original songs he wrote, and Titanic. Did I leave anything out? Oh, and Death Takes a Holiday is also in there.
How do you feel about Maury Estin?
Who's Maury Estin? Just kidding. God, I feel a lot of things about Maury Estin. I feel like as far as the musical theater bard goes, he's probably one of the most complete writers we have. You know, there are a lot of people are, some people are composers, some people are lyricists, and then they work, you know, in collaboration, but Maury is both a composer and a lyricist, and I think it lends itself really well and really completely to his work because, you know, all of his things fit together really well. I always say it's really appropriate that we're doing a review of his music because his songs are so complete. His songs inherently have a really strong sense of character, a strong sense of story. Every song has a beginning, middle, and an end. And it also has a very strong point of view. And a locale is in all those things are present in all of his work. So I think that's, I don't know. I think it's ironic that we're doing it. We're doing a Maury Estin review because his songs can all exist out of context and can exist by themselves. So that's been kind of the most interesting things, revisiting some of the stuff I knew, learning some of the stuff, the new stuff I didn't know, and then doing it out of context because it feels like every number we do is a complete story and a complete statement.
And I know it all elicits different kinds of emotions.
Yeah, you know, it elicits different kind of emotions, but hopefully it elicits different kind of emotions for the audience, I would say. Yeah, it does, because, how to sort of enter into this with the little bit of time that we have. Yeah, you know, Maury, it's funny because Maury, the main character in Maury's songs, me having worked with him now for the second time, the main character and kind of the main voice in his work, which I really like about it, is actually Maury. If you know him, you can hear him in all of his stuff. You can hear his voice. You can hear sort of his sort of style, I guess. And we're just as the actors, the vessel. So I think if as we do what's there and what he's written, yeah, it does elicit a lot of emotions for the audience. You know, the clearer we are with doing what's there, I believe it gives the audience clearer access to the material and a clearer access to, you know, the emotion that the piece elicits. So yes, the roundabout answer to that is yes, it elicits a lot of emotion. Yes, indeed.
Yeah, so definitely go. So thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Hey there, my name is Benjamin Eakley. Oh, and I'm playing man number one in Anything Can Happen in the Theater at the Fantastic York Theater. Anything Can Happen is a review of the top hits of Maury Yeston's songbooks. You can expect to hear The Best of Nine and Grand Hotel and Titanic, as well as a number of his standalone songs written for cabarets, as well as kind of concert venues as well. Just everything but the kitchen sink. However, everything is excellent.
Thank you. So, what does Maury Yeston mean to you? Have you ever sung his songs before?
Maury is one of my heroes, and I've been singing his songs for 20 years at the piano in times of happiness and sadness, but I've never sung for him before I auditioned for this. So walking into the room for him was a super cool experience because it was like meeting one of my heroes. But now singing with him 8 hours a day, every single day during rehearsals, and now recording his music as well for him and with him has been a dream come true, literally.
Do you have a favorite Maury Yeston song or show?
Absolutely. I think my favorite song of his canon might be I'm Longing from December Songs, followed by Simple from Nine, followed by Unusual Way and Call from... Actually, all the women's songs from Nine are spectacular, but the whole score is spectacular. What's your favorite song?
Oh, Death Takes a Holiday.
Oh, of course. December Songs is a song cycle written for soprano and orchestra and was originally recorded by Andrea Marcovici. I was introduced to it because my old voice teacher, Victoria Clark, was singing it with an orchestra years ago, and I saw her sing it. And this one song in the cycle, I can't remember if it's the last song or not, sorry, Maury, is called I Am Longing, and it is just an epic song that takes you through the arc of human emotion in one number.
Well, if anyone knows Maury Yeston, it's Victoria Clark. I mean, she was introduced to us in Titanic, and we all fell in love with her.
Mm-hmm. She's as nice of a human and as a person and a teacher as she is amazing on stage as well.
What do you think it is about Maury Yeston that just makes him so special? I mean, I think he is.
Yeah, I agree. And I think, actually, it's the combination of lyrics and music. And there's a lot of thought. There's not an excess of, but an excessive amount of thought behind every single number. And it's been one of the gifts of this experience, because if I have a question about any single lyric in any single song, I'll say, hey, Maury, you know, what does this come out of? And you will have an answer immediately. And that doesn't happen all the time. He cares as much about the story as he does about the music. His musical sensibility is also second to none. But when you have that emphasis on the lyric as well, it just makes it that much easier to perform, because it's the art of song. That's the gift that he's given us.
It also probably makes it easier because, like someone said before, you're telling a whole story. So you have a beginning, middle, and end. So you have a whole concept in your head.
That's absolutely true. And in the show, we have 23 standalone songs, so we have 23 standalone stories to learn, but also to get to perform for everybody, which is really, really cool and fun. Never boring.
And it shows how versatile you are, because basically you're playing 23 different characters.
Or 23 divided by 5, but wait till you see this cast. They are bonkers talented and also the nicest people ever.
Thank you very much.
Oh, such a pleasure. Nice to meet you.
Hi, I'm Mamie Paris, and I'm here with Anything Can Happen in the Theater, the music of Maury Yeston, who is just a stunning, hilarious, fabulously talented individual, and we're all so excited to sing this wonderful music.
And how do you perform? what makes your Yeston special to you?
You know, I've been a fan of Maury Yeston since I first heard the music from Nine, which I thought was so smart and just such, it's such an actor's piece, and I consider myself a singing actor. So I was always so in love with that score, and then I love, you know, Titanic is so lush. He's just, I find that he's a very versatile musician, and it makes it really enjoyable as a musician to perform his material, because no two things are alike. That's true. You know, Maury writes, has such a fluid musicality to him. He has such an intellectual musicality that it's easy for him to transition from something that feels like a pop tune or a contemporary kind of groove musical theater tune into something that would sound more operatic, that sounds really lush and full. And it's something that not everybody can do. Not every composer can do that. He's really quite, it's remarkable how he does that. And it's so lovely for someone like me, who's trained as a soprano, but performs so much contemporary musical theater, to get to kind of do both. It's really lovely.
And also, it's like, it's all his music is just all so different and such different subject matters. And yet it all comes out, it all tugs at your heart and makes you laugh at the same time.
It's so true. You know, affectionately, I would call Maury Yeston almost as a multiple personality composer, because he gets this idea in his head for exactly what a tune should feel and exactly what the character is and what the spirit of the moment is. And that drives the musical creation he makes. And so it can be very different. You know, we're performing Cinema Italiano from the movie version of Nine, which is all mod and very 60s and very down and groovy and spirited. You know, and at the same time, we'll perform a Titanic, which is this, like, just liquid, lush, huge, you know, but it's all driven by what the material is trying to say, what we're bringing across to the audience, what the characters are living, the time period. It's all appropriate, and it's just, it's such a gift to have an artist who is so good at shaping those different feels, those different energies for the stage, for the audience to enjoy.
Yeah, he's one of the best at serving the material.
It's true. It's true. You know, it's so wonderful when you can work with a writer or a director or a fellow actor who really derives so much of what they're doing from what the material is asking from them. You know, they're not reaching into a bag of tricks. They're specifically saying, how best can I honor this moment? You know, how best can I honor this incredible, you know, unheard of, unthinkable tragedy from 1912, the Titanic, and the feelings of these people, the grandness of the scale of the ship and the grandness and the scale of the tragedy, and how can I honor that, as well as something like a Nine, which is so, is really the midlife crisis of a middle-aged man and the women who affected him. It's such an intimate story, and the music really reflects that. Maury's writing really reflects each piece and honors it individually.
I agree. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. It's so good to be on the show.
Okay. Hi, my name is Giovanni Sean, and I play Mel 2 in Anything Can Happen in the Theater at the York Theater Company. And Maury Yeston is honestly like my dad. Like, I call him my father. I always call him, because he doesn't allow me to call him Mr. Maury Yeston, so I call him dad, because I just have such respect for this living legend, you know? And he's just taken me under his wing because I'm the baby of the cast and everything like that. And it's just been an amazing experience. It's also been very challenging, but I'm so grateful and so excited that everyone in New York City can see this amazing show and this amazing man's work. Because it's only five people, so you have to do harmonies, you can't go from character to different character, you know, like, we're not one consistent character throughout the show, we have different types of characters, so, which is, like, exciting, because I don't have to be the same character for the next 90 minutes, whereas most shows you do, so that's why it's challenging, especially because I just graduated from school, so this is, like, my first debut, you know, this is my off-Broadway debut, official debut, so, which I'm so excited about, and, yeah, it's challenging, because Maury Yeston's music is hard, you know, and you have to go there, and if you don't go there, then it's not done right.
Do you have a different, like, character you like doing more than others, like the sad one, the funny one, the, you know, operatic one?
I think my favorite character in the show is one of my solos, whereas, like, I just play this older, grounded man, whereas I substitute being like my grandfather in that song, and just allow myself to just be relaxed and to just go there old school, you know, suave, swooning and everything like that. So that's my favorite character in the show and everything like that. I also love being like a heartthrob, you know, the little heartthrob of the group, whereas like I make you want to cry, but yeah, you just like, oh, I feel for him, you know. So So yeah, that's my favorite characters in the show.
So what is it about More Yes that makes it just so moving and funny at the same time?
I think what makes More Yes than who he is because of just how authentic he is, because how real he is and how he allows the work to be done for you. You don't have to overcompensate. You don't have to force anything, whereas I can just live in the moment of his music and just allow the lyrics to just take me into the world that he wants me to go to. And I think that's what's so really beautiful about his work, and just also the creativity and the freedom that he gives his actors, you know, allowing you to go there, allowing you to add your little riffs and your little spunks and stuff like that, as well as like the characters. And I just think that it's just an honor to just be able to sing this living legend's music, you know.
Do you have a favorite more?
I think my favorite one, my favorite song, is the one that I'm singing in the show. It's I'm singing I Had a Dream About You. And it's one, huh? I think it's not from a musical, actually. I think that it's like unreleased and everything. I mean, I've seen other artists sing the song, but it's just one of the most prettiest songs that I've ever heard. And the lyrics are just so beautiful that they just make you go there, and that they just take you into the universe of where he wants you to be. And I think that's what's so great about his music, is that all I have to do is allow the lyrics to just come out, and it just takes me there, so which I really like.
So basically, it's not just his shows. He's opened up his trunk for this.
Yes. So we're going back to classics from Nine, Grand Hotel, Titanic, but then we're also doing songs that have never been released before, which is so beautiful, is that you're honoring his classics that have won him his Tonys, as well as unreleased music that he has had in his trunk that he's ready for the world to see, you know, so which is great.
Oh, any of them might be in a show, you think, in the future?
I don't know, definitely his Titanic stuff, you know. I don't know, maybe in the future, maybe, if that's what Mr. Yesen wants to do, but I don't know. We would have to just figure out and see and wait, you know, wait for the journey. Fingers crossed, because honestly, his music is just so beautiful, you know, and like, it's time that we bring him back and honor his work, you know, which is a blessing.
Thank God.
And their 50th anniversary, which is like iconic to be a part of, you know, which is so exciting, and which is a blessing, you know, to be a part of their 50th anniversary. Thank you so much for having me.
Hi, I'm Jerry McIntyre, and I'm the choreographer of Anything Can Happen in the Theater. And I did it uptown at the Triad, and it was small. The Triad's like a postage stamp. So I had to, you know, this lovely York State, so I got a lot of movement in it. And I suggested to them that we do Cinema Italiano, because I really wanted to do a little, like, Fosse kind of number. And it just, you know, it's just a lot of ballads in the show, so I thought I'd jazz it up. So I think that's my favorite one so far. And I'm really curious to see how the audience, you know, respond to the dancing. There's, like, three dance numbers that are dancing numbers more, you know, than singer dancer number. They're really dancing, and I think it's fantastic. I just really can't wait to the first audience so that I can hear the response. The last number is called Feet, and it's a lot of fun. There's a little tap, a little soft shoe section, so we'll see. It's really hard to do because it's not it's not based on characters, and I like to, you know, choreograph with a plot, with an idea, like, you know, if it's a book show. But so this is really like a challenge for me to do, because then you have to keep a through line through your movement for all the numbers that you do, and I hopefully achieve that. We'll see what happens. Yeah.
I just thought of something as a choreographer, because, you know, they're expelling a lot of energy, and then they have to sing. When you, as a choreographer, do you think about that, so you try to make the steps in a way so it tapers at the end so they can breathe and sing?
You know what I do? Because I'm a performer also, I do it. I do the song with the movement. So, I mean, I think if I could do it, then they can do it. Someone said to in the show, it's like, I really can't put my neck back because I'm singing a note. And I said, what note are you singing? And I said, tell me the note, and then I did it. I'm like, see, you can do it. I'm kind of mean, but it worked. I got it. You have to have tricks in this business. A lot of tricks. Thank you very much. It was nice to talk to you.
Okay. Hello, my name is Gerard Alessandrini, and I'm the director of Anything Can Happen in the Theater, the new review of the works of Mor Yeston, the world of Mor Yeston, the great Broadway writer, composer, lyricist that produced such wonderful, not produced, but wrote such wonderful shows as Nine, Titanic, Grand Hotel, and his own version of Phantom that's heard around the world. I'm the director of Anything Can Happen in the Theater, which is a review of the songs from those shows and many other shows, and also shows that were never produced or songs he wrote for this version. So it's quite a mix of material. It's some famous songs that everybody knows and loves. It's got some wonderful obscure songs. It's got some new songs. It's about, almost half new material with your favorites from Titanic and Grand Hotel and Nine. And I said to Maury, I've worked with him before, directing one of his shows, and I've known him through the BMI workshop. And I said to Maury, you have to have a review format of your work because so much of the material you can take out of context. And yet it is also fun to do some of the songs in context. So he's got a great view of work, and we wanted to show you all the variants and subtleties and contrasting elements of that. So that's what I worked for to get this into Anything Can Happen in the Theater. We have a wonderful cast. We're going to be doing it at the York Theater all through December and maybe beyond. And we'd love to share it with you, so come and enjoy this great composer-lyricist. You know, sometimes you could say that some of the newer shows don't have as high a bar as we used to have on Broadway. Hamilton excluded, of course, that's wonderful. But it's great to have this type of music back on the stage and back in front of people. It'll just make everybody very happy.
With all the songs to choose from, how were you able to narrow it down?
It was very hard. It took years. We went through all his material, which is hundreds of songs, and I went through all of that and even played me some that nobody ever heard before. But, you know, we got it down to two dozen songs that really fit into review format and that, you know, are high contrasting. And then he wrote a couple of new songs for spaces to make it all fit together. But it was a lot of material to go through. It was fun to go through all the material and hear things I hadn't heard before and learn a lot about Mor Yeston's work. And he's a genius in that way. Very prolific, very thorough, very varied. Not varied like Verity, the composer, but varied, you know, very contrasting. So, although you could say, in a way, he is akin to classical music, because he was a musicologist at Yale, and there is something about his music that's as profound as the classical artist, yet it's light and musical theater-like, which is beautiful and wonderful to behold and hear.
I know, you must have been very goosebumpy the entire time.
Oh, absolutely, and it was just wonderful. Oh, you hear this, I mean, wouldn't it be wonderful to do this, to get some wonderful artists to do this. We've assembled a really great cast, and they're singing the songs at their optimum in performance.
And I would be remiss if I didn't bring up your Forbidden Broadway that's going on right now.
That's right. I have a parallel career to doing real musicals. I actually do direct real musicals and reviews and have written a few real musicals myself. But I'm most famous for doing Forbidden Broadway. And I haven't done a Forbidden Broadway in about 5 years, so it was time to do a new one with all the big new Broadway shows like Evan Hansen and Beetlejuice and Tootsie and revivals like Oklahoma. So it was time to do a new one. In between, I did one big spoof of Hamilton called Spamilton. So I've been busy in the parody field, and I love doing it. It's really fun to do. But it's running at the Triad. It's only running there till December 1st. But we have a theater that might be interested in picking it up. I don't know. You know any theaters around here? So watch the papers. So what? Yeah. No, we're going to have a different formula because we'll be announcing it soon. But I think we're going to move it.
Hi, drama. I'm Mor Yeston here on the stage of the soon-to-be opening Anything Can Happen in the Theater. and it's a review conceived by Gerard Alessandrini of my work, pop tunes and excerpts from musicals and all kinds of things, some comedy and some things that are touching and moving, some big company numbers, some wonderful dancing. And please come see us because we're having a great time here.
So how did you pick what you picked and all that? And also, I've got to say, your music just tugs at the heartstring. It's just, there's this beautiful operatic quality, and I don't even like opera, but you know what I mean? That beautiful full tone. It doesn't matter whether it's Broadway or off-Broadway. I mean, especially Death Takes a Holiday. That is like my all-time favorite score.
That's very kind of you to say. Well, you know, I come from a long tradition of melody. Jerome Kern and Irving Berlin and George Gershwin and Frank Lesser and all of these people are my idols. And they have shown that you can tell a story with a melody alone and it touches people's hearts. You can be funny as well. You know, there's a wonderful line from an E.E. Cummings poem. He wrote, "Since feeling is first, who pays attention to the syntax of things will never wholly kiss you." And I want my work to kiss the audience the way my idols work, like Berlin's or Gershwin or Harold Rome. And I think that's been my life project. And I feel very privileged to be able to do that. And I think that's why. But, you know, it's not just sappy romantic things. It's also comedy and rhythm and dance. Music can make you leap for joy. It can make you cry. And I'm interested in all of those feelings.
How did you come up with these projects in the first place? I mean, there's something Titanic, Nine, Death Takes a Holiday, Grand Hotel. They're all so different. And, like, you wouldn't even think they'd be musicals, but you turned them into these incredible musicals.
Well, some of the projects I've done were writer inspired. I knew that the story of the Titanic could be a great story with big music and intimate stories about bravery. And I knew that even though it lowers expectations, people come into the theater and go, "Show me." I mean, you know, how can you possibly make a musical out of the worst maritime disaster in history? But the truth is, there are people on that ship, and they were having the time of their lives until they hit the iceberg. And then afterwards, there was some cowardice, some incredible bravery, and of course the magnificent story of Mrs. Strauss, who was married to the owner of Macy's, and of all of every single first class woman was in a lifeboat, except for her, because she chose to stay with her husband until the end, because she loved him more than life itself. And so I was so inspired by those stories, I thought, well, if I'm inspired by them, maybe other people will be as well. Sometimes you get invited by somebody else. Tommy Toon called me up and invited me to come join the team of Grand Hotel, and that was a great honor to do that. But, you know, you just get an idea somewhere and run with it. You know, it can be thankless because it can take years and years and years, but in the end, what matters is only the work, you know, and if whatever your process is has led you to write something that you're proud of, that you can touch other people with and make a contact with a connection with the world, then for me it's worth all the time and all the work.
I just thought about when you were talking about the Titanic, it made me realize your shows all have like a very intense love story in them.
Yeah, because there are many different kinds of love besides romantic love. I think I write about people, and people hate, but they also love. You know, it was very interesting. I became almost an encyclopedia of facts about the Titanic, and yet my favorite moment, and probably one of the best moments in that show, came out of my thinking, well, you know, I've met this stoker kissing his girlfriend goodbye on the dock before the ship takes off and begins its journey. And I thought, and he meets this telegraph operator, and I thought, well, what if halfway through the show, he's afraid that his girlfriend won't wait for him and she'll marry somebody else? So he sneaks up to the telegraph room at midnight and says to the telegraph guy, "Can you send it? I want to propose to my girlfriend. Can you send this message?" And of course, telegraph had just been invented. And he said, yeah. And so it becomes a duet, right? With a kind of a double love song in which the stoker is proposing to the girl he loves, and the telegraph operator is doing it through this medium of this new telegraph, which he loves, and he finds himself in the middle of a love story. And that duet, which is one of the high points for me in an event of the show, has nothing to do with the history of the Titanic, has nothing to do with the history of anything. It's just a moment because I've brought something to it that wasn't there before. And I think the lesson there is that there's a great saying, actually, in a music theory book written by an author who wrote a book about, you know, fundamentals of music, that actually Beethoven used as a textbook. And it's written as a dialogue between a teacher and a student. And the student says, "Maestro, is it permitted to borrow music?" And the teacher says, "Yes, as long as you pay back with interest." And I think that if you're going to do something like the Titanic, you can't just take the story of the Titanic. You have to bring something to it. You have to pay back with interest. Put something new. Otherwise, show a movie about the Titanic and don't put any music in it. And so I think that's the really most rewarding thing about writing these shows, is that you get to add something to the story that wasn't there before, that makes it worth all the work that you put into it.
Come to the York to see this. It looks amazing.